Good evening and welcome to our board meeting for March 7, 2016. Will the village clerk please take the roll?
Mayor Broda.
Present.
Trustee Boyle.
Here.
Trustee Carballo.
Here.
Trustee Coitzel.
Here.
Trustee Getz is absent. Trustee Hedick.
Here.
Trustee Mandel.
Here.
Village Manager Sprecher.
Here.
Assistant Village Manager Ertmode.
Here.
Community and Economic Development Director Bud Zukowski.
Here.
Economic Development Coordinator Kelly.
Here.
Finance Director Schiller.
Here.
Staff Engineer and Stormwater Administrator Suco.
Here.
Village Attorney Silverman.
Here.
Deputy Village Clerk Arnold.
Here.
Deputy Village Clerk Curran.
Here.
Village Clerk Seaton present.
Please rise for the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. I will now turn the meeting over to Village Clerk Seaton.
Thank you, Mayor. Visitors are most welcome to all meetings of the Village Board. Persons wishing to discuss an item that is on the agenda may address the board at the time the item is being discussed. Please raise your hand when the item is announced and wait to be recognized by the mayor. It is requested that, if possible, one spokesperson for a group be appointed to present the views of the entire group. Anyone wishing to discuss a topic that is not on the pre-printed agenda may address the Village Board during the open forum portion of the meeting. Speakers will be asked to step to the podium and state their name and identify any group they may be representing. There will be a 5-minute time limit per speaker. And at this time, ladies and gentlemen, we would request that all cell phones and pagers please be turned off. Thank you. Mayor, turning to our audience participation for both agenda and non-agenda items this evening from our audience members, we do not have anyone who has signed in. So with that, I would look for a meeting minute approval of the Village Board workshop session of February 8th, 2016, and the Village Board regular meeting of February 15th, 2016.
I move to approve the Village Board meeting minutes as presented.
Second.
There's a motion and second. Hearing no further discussion, all those in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed? Hearing none, motion carries.
Mayor, we have no request for raffle licenses. However, we do have several meeting announcements, and unless otherwise noted, the meetings are at 7 p.m. and they're located here at the Village Hall. The next Village Board workshop will be held on March 14th. Planning and Zoning Commission will meet on March 16th. A reminder that Sustainable Saturday will be held at Benedictine University on March 19th from 9 a.m. until 12 noon. More information is available on our website. And finally, the next Village Board meeting will be held on March 21st. Mayor, that concludes my portion of the agenda.
Thank you, Clerk Seaton. We'll move on to my portion of the agenda. The first item I have is a presentation from our local VFW group, VFW Post 5696, to make a brief presentation in regards to a program they want to get going.
Good evening, Mayor. Thank you very much. Board members, good evening. I'm Brett Nyla, past post commander of the Lyle VFW, and I'm here to tell you about a fundraising event we have planned for the Lyle VFW. It will be a colorful, attention-getting event that will tie in with Memorial Day and Lyle's 60th anniversary. We've dubbed this event the Remembrance Field at Dragonfly Landing. It will be a display of 60 or more 3x5 flags, like the one here on my right, on 8-foot poles, like this one, weaving throughout the park along the path from Friday, May 27th through Memorial Day on May 31st. Each flag in the display will be the result of a $35 donation from someone wishing to commemorate someone. So, for $35, a sponsor will receive a 3x5 flag on the 8-foot pole with a tag identifying the person or party they're commemorating. Mayor Broda was the first to sign on with this, and so he, from personal experience, can explain how that process works. The VFW would then retain possession of each flag until after July 4th to ensure all flags are mounted for the display opening on May 27th. Then, the VFW will retire the display on May 31st. The flags can then be remounted for the July 4th festivities. After July 4th, sponsors can come to the VFW and pick up their flags and poles. Now, this $35 donation is based upon a total cost of $30 for each flag. That's the purchase of the flag itself, the pole, the mounting hardware, and the shipping. The VFW will make a $5 profit on each flag that is sponsored. Based upon interest that's already sparked, we're certain to find at least 60 sponsors. In fact, we're confident that twice that many, or at least 120, will sign on. Now, in order to acquire the flags needed, we have recently applied to the Special Events Grant Program, requesting $3,000 to cover the cost of over 120 flags. Our intent is for this to be an annual event. In addition to seeking new sponsors and flags each year, previous sponsors will be invited to bring their flags back, and for a $5 donation, their flags will be mounted in the new display. So, we ask your support as we go out into the community and try to make this fundraiser work. Again, Mayor, thank you for being the first. We've already got, I think, 25 already signed up, so we're well on our way. And we would appreciate any support. Any questions? I'm happy to entertain any questions at this time.
Okay, I do have one very important question.
Yes.
How does one go about obtaining a flag?
Okay, one would go about obtaining a flag by stopping by the VFW, or you could even call, and through either check or cash, we would take then the funds, we give you a receipt, and then at the same time, we'll also give you the yellow tag. And on that yellow tag, you can put on there how you want the wording to come out in terms of who you wish to commemorate. And then just make sure that your flag is back to the VFW then, whether you do it there or you return it to the VFW, so that the VFW has all the flags prior to the Memorial Day weekend. Because then what we're going to do is we're going to have all the flags and then mount them for the display. And then we'll retire the display after the Memorial Day weekend, after which we'll hang on to them. And then for the 4th of July festivities, we'll remount them.
And what is the phone number?
The phone number is here. In fact, I've got all the phone numbers right here. You can call Dennis Lovick, actually. Dennis Lovick and his wife Maureen, they're the ones who are actually spearheading this effort. Dennis's cell phone number is area code 847-651-7762. Or you could also email him at dlovick, that's D-L-O-V-I-C-K 195 at AOL.com.
Very good.
All right.
Does anybody else have any questions of Brent?
This, first off, great concept. This is very cool. This may be a stupid question, but is this a remembrance flag? So for somebody that may have passed, or can this also be commemorated to somebody currently serving or who has served?
This could commemorate someone who is also currently serving. So it does not have to be relegated as simply a remembrance of those who have passed. It can be for someone who is still actively serving or whoever.
Thank you.
Okay.
For example, we put my father-in-law, who basically was discharged from the service in 1946, February 19th, and that's been 70 years ago. Just thinking about when we're putting the information together, we had to go and research the archives that my mother-in-law had passed on to my wife about the family members who served, and it was very interesting to research that information. You know, I just told my wife, it's 70 years ago.
It's amazing what people can find online now with researching and what is available in terms of service records of individuals and such, and the units that they served with. So.
Go to the podium, please. The microphone.
I'm going to be there anyway. The answer to the question, the reason we stated it as remembrance, because Memorial Day is obviously a few days away, and those are for the people who have departed. Remembrance was for, okay, anyone, a friend or family member who's in the service And it's actually like you could do first responders on this, because after 9/11, we're all in the same battle together. But it was sort of tie on in the living as well as the ones who have passed away. And that's why we choose remembrance field versus a memorial field. Okay, so there was a specific reason for that name to tie in all those people for it. Okay.
So it wasn't a stupid question. A very good one. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
All right.
Any other questions by board members? If not, I hope the message gets out. Now, this will be replayed many times, so this part of the presentation, you know, hopefully be reviewed by many of the viewers and the residents of the community. Okay?
Again, thank you for
thank
your
you
time.
Thank you so much.
Good evening.
Moving on our agenda tonight, we'll go right into the omnibus vote agenda. Staff has requested that we pull item number 12. So can I have a motion for 1 through 11, please? Or does anybody else want anything pulled?
I move to place agenda items 3B, 1 through 11, inclusively as omnibus vote agenda items. Further, I move that all items be considered together as the omnibus vote agenda.
Second.
There's a motion and second. Hearing no further discussion, I will ask the village clerk to please take the roll.
Trustee Boyle.
Aye.
Trustee Mandel.
Aye.
Trustee Carballo.
Aye.
Trustee Kwitzel.
Aye.
Trustee Hedick.
Aye.
Mayor Broda.
Aye, and motion carries.
I move to adopt agenda items 3B, 1 through 11, inclusively on the omnibus vote agenda in a single group pursuant to the omnibus vote procedures specified in the Illinois Municipal Code.
Second.
There's a motion and second. Once again, hearing no further discussion, I'll ask the village clerk to please take the roll.
Trustee Boyle.
Aye.
Trustee Mandel.
Aye.
Trustee Carballo.
Aye.
Trustee Kwitzel.
Aye.
Trustee Hedick.
Aye.
Mayor Broda.
Aye, and motion carries. Moving on, the first item we have, a final, pardon? We pull that from the agenda, okay. Moving on with guidance for final action, special event permit for wine extravaganza. Can I have a motion, please?
I move to approve a special event permit for June 18th wine extravaganza as presented.
Second.
There's a motion and second. Hearing no further discussion, I will ask the village clerk to please take the roll.
Trustee Boyle.
Aye.
Trustee Carballo.
Aye.
Trustee Kwitzel.
Aye.
Trustee Hedick.
Aye.
Trustee Mandel.
Aye.
Motion carries. I didn't need a roll for that. I thought it was something else. Moving on to the next one is the CDBG DR grant with the DuPage County and the Village of Lisle, the resolution. Can I have a motion, please?
I move to approve a resolution authorizing execution of a community development block grant to debt disaster recovery agreement between the County of DuPage and the Village of Lisle.
Second.
There's a motion and second. Is there any discussion or comments by board members before we go on with the vote? Hearing none, I'll ask the village clerk to please take the roll.
Trustee Boyle.
Aye.
Trustee Hedick.
Aye.
Trustee Carballo.
Aye.
Trustee Kwitzel.
Aye.
Trustee Mandel.
Aye.
And motion carries. Moving on our agenda, we'll go to the next item, which is a public hearing for the 2016-2017 annual budget. At this time, I will open the public hearing and have the village clerk read the hearing notice.
Thank you, Mayor. The corporate authorities of the Village of Lisle, DuPage County, Illinois, will conduct a public hearing at 7 p.m. on Monday, March 7th, 2016, in the Village Board Room of the Village Hall, 925 Burlington Avenue, Lisle, Illinois, regarding the adoption of the annual budget for the Village of Lisle for the fiscal year beginning on May 1st, 2016, and ending April 30th, 2017, as well as the adoption of the revised budget for the fiscal year that began on May 1st, 2015, and which will end on April 30th, 2016. Said public hearing is being held in accordance with the provisions of Chapter 65, Section 58-29 of the Illinois Compiled Statutes. The tentative annual budget for fiscal year 2016-2017 and the tentative revised budget for fiscal year 2015 and 2016 are available for public inspection in the office of the village clerk, 925 Burlington Avenue, Lisle, Illinois, during the normal Village of Lisle business hours, 7 a.m. until 5 p.m. Monday through Friday. This is published by the corporate authorities of the Village of Lisle, Kimberly Schiller, Municipal Budget Officer.
Thank you, Clerk Seaton. At this time, I'll turn the meeting over to Finance Director Schiller.
Thank you. Before you, you have draft three of the proposed revised 2015-16 and proposed 16-17. Some of the items to note in this draft are for the revenues. We're proposing to keep the water rate as it is currently at $6.50 per 1,000 gallons in village rate, but we are going to redistribute that rate amongst the three funds that make up that rate. And we're changing between the Water Fund 03 and the DWC Fund 36, to account for the timing of when we have to pay the DuPage Water Commission for the water and when we're actually collecting it from the water customers. So that's what we're proposing to change, just the allocation, not the rate. On the expenditure side, we've noted a few items that we've revised in this draft that we had previously discussed at the workshop in February. Couple of items that we will be looking at in draft four, which we're anticipating to present to you on March 21st. And hopefully with a budget ordinance for approval. Couple of the items for draft four that we're anticipating on the revenue side, we're continuing to monitor our revenues, particularly the sales tax, especially in light of comments by Trustee Mandel and Trustee Getz at previous meetings that we had. We're hoping to get more detail soon in regard to the sales taxes from the recent annexations, which will help us in this analysis and determine how the rest of the businesses are trending currently. We will revise the budget projections if appropriate, including on the expenditure side if necessary. We anticipate to get more of that detail from the Illinois Department of Revenue hopefully soon. On the expenditure side, we will be revising the special census numbers. After we had produced all the reports, we've got the cost estimate from the Census Bureau, which instead of the $45,000 we have budgeted, it's projected to be about $75,000. In light of the potential revenue that we would be seeing from an increase in population, we certainly think that it's still well worth going through that drill to get those additional numbers, particularly for our state shared revenues that are population based, such as the income tax and motor fuel tax and the local use tax. We will also be looking at potentially revising restaurant grants, but that's going to hinge on our discussion at the March 14th workshop when we'll be talking about the hotel motel tax, the two hotel motel tax funds. So we will be discussing that next week. So those may change. Other revenue and expenditure items, I don't have all the particulars yet, but we'll be most likely revising some, particularly the revenues due to actuals and any of the carryovers we requested, the list from departments as to projects or items that and services that may not be finished this fiscal year that we'll have to carry over into next. So again, we anticipate the presentation of our draft four at our next Village Board meeting on March 21st.
Does anybody have any questions of Director Schiller? If not, I'll open it up. Does anybody in the audience have any questions in regards to the budget for 2016-17? Please take the podium, state your name and address for the record, please.
Good Good evening, Mayor Broda. My name is Colette Jordan, 4504 Dorset Avenue, Lisle. And I had a question. I attended the budget meeting workshop last month, and I'm one of the residents that flooded in 2013, and I represent the citizens to preserve Lisle Group that we had formed, you know, in the fall. And I just wanted to state that I'm kind of disappointed that there's no information or flood remediation plans in the 2016-17 budget. So I wanted to state my concern that there's no plans for, you know, flood remediation included in the budget. There's lots of line items for what I consider, and some people of Lisle consider frivolous in the budget, for frivolous expenditures, sorry. And, you know, I'd like some guidance from the board on how we can, you know, work into the budget a long-term flood remediation plan. Being new at this, as a citizen, you know, I've been here for 27 years, but being new at addressing the board and being involved in flood remediation and my concerns since the flood of 2013, I'd just like some advice and to go on record saying that, you know, I think that there needs to be more done as far as adding to long-term budgeting for flood remediation and the concerns of hundreds of residents in Lisle that live in the floodplain.
Okay, thank you. Is there anybody else that would like to say a few words in regards?
Do you have a response for her?
Pardon?
Do you have a response for her question?
No, I don't, because this is a public input for our public, it's a public hearing. This is not a Q&A.
Okay.
With that, is there anybody else?
Yes.
Okay, you are coming down.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Sorry, I'm not familiar with all the doings and the goings-on and how their things are addressed either. I'm Nadine Salomon. I own a home at 4520 Wabansi Lane.
What's your name, too, so we have your name?
Nadine Salomon.
Okay.
You may have seen some of my posts on Watchdog. I'm not a happy camper in the village these days, and much of it has to do with the budgets. One of the items on your agenda is regarding reducing payments owed to the water fund, for which I understand that money was used for downtown improvements. And I'm wondering about the village's finances, because I have been told that you can't afford the BU payment for the sports complex, and I've also been told that you want this payment reduction because the finances in Lisle aren't where they should be because of some bad financial decisions on the part of the village. My biggest question is why the village continues to give away the taxpayer money to Ramey's, Your Buena, the Mexican restaurant. I understand you're proposing to give them $40,000. That would be what, the second Mexican restaurant that's been given money on Maple Avenue in the last several weeks. And if you count up the money that was given to Marquette and some of the other local establishments, they add up to over $1 million in the last year and a half or so. So my concern is if you're not able to pay your bills, why are you giving taxpayers money away? Some of the money in the past has included to Contempo Dance and to the John Doe Bakery. They are not here. So the money that you gave them didn't help them stay in Lisle. And the money that was used from the water fund that has been given to the downtown fund, the downtown is dying. I mean, it's in bad shape, and it's obviously needs addressed pretty soon. You're not getting tax revenue, you're not getting hotel revenue, and you're not, and the big businesses up on Warrenville Road are moving out. So as they move out, there's less money for hotels, they are not paying the same taxes. So don't you think that it's in order at this point to do some belt tightening rather than ask for 3% increases for board members? I'm sorry, for village employees? Now, I'll quit there, but I think a lot of residents have some concern in regards to how their taxpayer dollar is being spent and or, in this case, given away. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there anybody else?
Good evening, all. My name is T.J. Rydell, 1309 Burlington Avenue. This is my first year in Lyle watching the budget process, and I would like to call out a couple of points that I've discovered through this. First of all, there was a budget workshop where the entire assembly was gathered around the table, and we have this magnificent sound system. We have a gentleman in the booth there controlling the microphones. The audience could not hear probably a third, a little bit more of the conversation going on during that workshop. Second, as I see inside the budget, we're paying, I forget the name of the company, we're paying some IT consulting company $25,000 a month to run servers, make information available online, and yet we get the budget redact, and it's a scanned copy, which prevents any of us when receiving a, 575-page packet, from scanning through that budget, looking for particular line items that may be of interest to us. I know I won't get an answer, but I would like to ask why. To the other points that were raised, we know we have issues in the village here. We know what they are. We heard part of it at the workshop meeting. What's being done? Again, I know I won't get an answer. I'm raising this for the public record in the hopes that maybe some of you will agree that this village needs more transparency than the citizens are getting. Thank you.
Is there anybody else who has a question or comment? If not, I will ask for any questions from the board. If no questions, I'll ask for a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved.
Sir.
There's a motion and second to close the public hearing. Hearing no comments, or all those in favor, they by saying aye.
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 Motion carries. The public hearing is closed. Moving on our agenda tonight, the next item is presentation from ComEd about smart meters.
Good evening, Mayor Broda. Good evening to the trustees and to all assembled here. My name is Phil Halliburton. I am your new current interim external affairs manager for ComEd for the Village of Lyle. A majority of you probably know Terry Simmons as your external affairs contact. Terry has taken on a special assignment, so she will be out for about a year. And so if there's any information or anything that you guys need, I will be your new contact. We're here tonight to present to you information about our AMI smart meter program. I have with me today our vice president for AMI deployment, Mike McMahon. Mike will be doing the presentation to the council tonight, and if you do have any questions afterwards, feel free to give us a call.
Well, first, thanks for having us here tonight. ComEd is about halfway through its deployment of smart meters. We were authorized in the 2011 Energy Infrastructure Modernization Act passed by the Illinois State Legislature more than once to install smart meters across the service territory. We have about 4 million smart meters to install in our service territory. We're just about at 2 million meters right now. In terms of Lyle, we will be installing meters beginning this August. I have a map here I can hand out and hand around if you'd like to. Can I hand this to somebody? You guys want to see it?
Yes.
Yeah. Oh, there you go. Okay. What that map shows is that we're gonna start in September. We're gonna finish August with the residential meters. There's about 11,000, I think it's 700 meters in Lisle. The balance of those meters will be installed throughout the rest of the year. They represent specialty meters, either commercial, industrial, or what we call A-base meters. But for the most part, we're going to be in Lisle and out in 2 months this year. Your residents are going to get a series of communications. Your residents, our customers, will get a series of communications. It will start with a bill insert, and the date for that, the target date for that is May 13th. So let me find it here. Okay, starts with a, let me do it this way. Make it easy.
We'll start with a bill insert. That will come out in about May. And then about 60 days before we come to install, we'll send out a postcard saying smart meters are on their way. Please be aware. 30 days in advance, we send a letter signed by yours truly. That letter will say we're going to be in your neighborhood in the next 30 to 45 days.
Could you, would you get to better microphone because it's not being picked up and you're too far away?
Yeah, there you go. We're going to go back and forth a little bit. A letter 30 to 40 days in advance saying we're going to be in your neighborhood installing smart meters. If you'd like to call for an appointment or if you have any questions, please give us a call. There'll be a robocall 10 days in advance. It's not a human being, it's a robocall. It says we'll be in your neighborhood in the next 10 days. Please leave gates open and your dogs inside. The day of, the meter installer will approach the resident. He'll knock on the door. He'll engage the resident, answer any questions they may have, and provide them with a door hanger, whether they're home or not. If they're not home and he has access to the meter, he'll go right ahead and install the meter. Then 30 days afterwards, they get yet another mailing saying, congratulations, you got a smart meter. This is how you take advantages of some of the programs offered that. And 60 days afterwards, they get yet another mailing saying, you've got a smart meter. Please sign up on ComEd.com to take advantage. Now, that's a lot of communications. I gotta have one more. That's a lot of communications that we send out, but what we know from our national builds, from our national experiences, is this is not a build it and they will come. It is a little bit different for folks. And so we have a robust change management program and communication program. Our refusal rate on smart meters is extremely low, 0.1%. We've got almost 2 million meters installed. We have about 1,800 customers that have said, no thanks, I don't want a meter. If those, and anybody can refuse a meter for any reason. Now, and you can do it through any channel. You can call a call center and say, I refuse. You can refuse the day of. You can send a letter any way you want. We don't care. Now, we're not going to leave you alone on that. We're going to ask you why. We're going to try to give you third-party information. We're going to address your concerns. And in fact, about 50% of the people that do refuse, after we talk to them and give them the facts, it's just not our facts, third-party facts, you know, as well. We have a long list of information available to folks. They'll say, okay, now I understand. I'll go ahead and take the meter. If somebody's not home, they get a sorry we missed your card. Please give us a call to schedule an appointment to take the meter. Now on that, you'll see also that anyone after, that's it. After, thank you very much, Phil, that's it. After a 4-month time period of multiple communications with the customers, if they refuse, there's an additional charge placed on their bill of $21.53. It's not a surprise, they know this has been coming, we've been talking to them. Refusals get 2 letters. People that don't open their gates or won't let us in get 4 letters. You know, now you might say, well, why is that? You know, what's the big difference? Well, smart meters are our standard now. That's our standard service. And we are reducing our cost and passing those cost savings on to our customers by the elimination of meter readers over a period of time. If you, as a customer, want to refuse a smart meter, that's fine, but I still have to keep a meter reader on property just to go out and read your meter, and that costs money. So the notion in the tariff, it's an approved Illinois tariff, is the cost causer should bear the cost. Mike should not have, should Phil have to pay for me refusing a meter? And the answer is no. If I want to refuse a meter, I should bear the cost. That's what the 2153 is for. It doesn't actually cover our entire cost, but it's sufficient and it's approved by the ICC. This is the meter you have right now. Sorry, Phil, there's two more. This is the meter you have right now. It's just an analog meter. It's a dumb meter. It does absolutely nothing. It's a pass-through device for electricity. Meter reader has to go out on your property every single month to be able to read that. This is a smart meter. Nothing mysterious about it. It's a digital device. What makes a smart meter smart? It has a small computer chip in it, which stores interval usage on that. It has two small radios. One communicates with us, and one communicates with the customer if they choose to. The communications, one of the myths out there, is that the communication, the radio operates continuously. It does not. The total on time for that meter is less than 5 minutes a day. Less than 5 minutes a day. That's all communications of all types. We read the meter six times a day. We pull the reads off the meter six times a day, and then we store that information in 30-minute increments. If the customer wants to, that we're done now for sure. Oh, okay. If the customer wants to, they're able to view on the web the day after their electricity usage in 30-minute increments, and that can help them better manage their usage. One of the things that you're able to do is you can determine what your vampire load is in your house. So even if you turn everything out on your house, you're still drawing electricity. That's that little red light on the microwave, that's the clock over the oven, that's your Wi-Fi device working. If you determine your vampire load and then you figure out what that is, you can check before you leave for work. Takes an in-home device to do this, but you can check to leave before you leave for work. And if you have anything on, you can go around, find out, and turn it off. We know people have done this, and they've saved over 30% on their electricity bill. In Lyle, your installers will be our approved vendor, Corix. Corix is, they will carry a badge, ComEd a contractor. They will have a logoed vehicle. It says Corix on the side. We encourage people to ask for those badges. If they can't produce it, shut the door, call the police. It's not us. We will never ask for money. If there's anybody on anybody's doorstep asking for money, representing themselves as ComEd or ComEd Smart Meters, close the door, call the police. It is not us. We will never ask for money. One of the things we'll do here is we know that the meter is new. But the fitting that the meter goes into is owned by the customer, that's customer property, and it's typically as old as the home. So we know from our lessons learned to inspect this fitting, and if there is any damage or it's in a degraded condition, we'll make repairs to that fitting, and we have licensed union electricians on standby to make those repairs. Of course, we have to talk to the customer because they're going to incur most of the time, you know, some sort of power outage. When that happens, but if so, we have licensed union electricians to make those repairs. Once again, no direct charge to the customer, all goes in the rate base. Pretty proud of this. We did over 5,000 repairs last year, so it's not unusual for us to make these repairs. We're leaving our customers, your constituents, safer than when we found them. Corix, I heard just the other day Corix, with a few exceptions, are all journeyman electricians out of local IBWs. These guys are electrical professionals. I have personally authorized a few exceptions to these in a few categories, either through personal recommendations or some special schooling that they went through, but the majority of all our installers are licensed journeyman electricians. So I'll pause there for questions.
Well, I do have a question. The primary difference between a smart meter and a dumb meter is that the smart meter will be communicating on a regular basis usage so a homeowner can really manage their usage.
That's correct.
And the meters we have today, now let me ask something more basic than that. In the past, we have outages.
Yeah.
And the way the grids are set up, there may be four or five houses on a grid.
Right.
Some grids may have hundreds of homes on
right.
a grid. In the old system, there was no way for you to know about that at that central office, so to speak.
That's
smart
right.
Smart meters, my understanding, will be able to transmit a signal saying, hey, I'm not
right.
responding.
Right.
Okay.
Right. The smart meter has a device. It's called a last gasp. So when the smart meter loses power for any reason, it sends us a signal saying, I have lost power. Now that helps us out in two different ways. One is theft. So a lot of people will pull their meter out and they'll jumper the fitting inside. They'll do a lot of elaborate things to steal electricity. And by the way, you all pay for that. That gets socialized across the rate base. So when a smart meter now gets pulled, it sends us a last gasp that says, I have lost power. Well, that means something's up, particularly if it lost it on a blue sky day, what we call a perfectly normal day. We have a metric in place that says we have to reduce our energy theft by 50% over a 10-year period. We're well ahead of that. I've got lots of stories where we have caught some folks red-handed, I mean, meter in hand, and then prosecuted them accordingly for this. So theft helps, reduces it. That reduces everybody's rates. The last gasp during a big storm tells us who's out. We're able to map that out, send people to the heaviest hit areas. But we also have the ability to do what's called ping the meter. So that's, I send a signal to the meter and I say, are you on or are you off? That's very important, particularly the tail end of storms, because at the tail end of a storm, you're down to your onesie, twosies, threesies, foursies, you know, it's pretty slow going. 50% of our trucks are okay on arrival. That means when they get to the resident, 50% of the time, that resident already has power. Well, smart meters, I'm able to ping those meters, and it'll say, are you on or are you off? And I only send the trucks to the people that do not have power. Last year in 2015, remember, I'm halfway deployed now. When I started 2015, I was about a quarter of the way there. Last year in 2015, we avoided 19,000 truck rolls. That means that 19,000 times I sent that truck to somebody without power instead of sending it to somebody with power. It's very powerful. And then we've got some apps that are coming out now as well. That if you have a smart meter and you signed up for your ComEd.com account, which we encourage everybody to, there's a few other benefits I can talk to as well if you'd like me to. But you can report an outage on your app. You report an outage. Now when you do this, you hit the button that says reporting an outage. If you have a smart meter, it will say, wait 1 second, we're checking your service. This takes less than a minute. Your reporting of an outage on that app automatically pings your meter. You will get a signal back from us saying, we checked your power, it looks like everything's okay on our side, would you still like to report an outage? Or would you like to check your home, breakers and such, to make sure we think the problem's in your home? That program has only been in place for about 2.5 months now. We've saved over 2,000 truck rolls. That's 2,000 people that reported an outage on their app, but then didn't follow up. So once again, shorter outage durations, particularly at the end of storms. I can talk about nested outages if you want, but our OCC, the people that run these storms, they're very excited about this. You know you got something when people are pulling in the technology, and that's exactly what's happening in this case.
Thank you. Anybody have any questions of Bob?
Just thanks for all that. Question on, in the literature that we received up here that I understand that's going out, it mentions operational savings being passed on to consumers.
Right.
So I understand that there's all the, you know, that there's apps, there's better information
yeah.
in order for people to better manage their electricity during
right.
peak times and stuff.
Yeah.
That's
okay.
all great.
Good.
What about someone that doesn't take advantage of that
yeah.
for some reason? There should be, all things being equal, based on the 19,000 truck roll
yeah.
savings, based on you know, I read meters as a kid.
Yep.
So there's reductions in truck rolls.
You don't need that job anymore?
What's that?
Don't want to be a meter reader anymore?
No, I did that for a couple
seasons.
We
still have a need for good meter readers. So.
No, I set records for a number of meters, and it didn't make a lot of the full 10 people happy over the summer.
Right.
So, but in terms of, but there should be savings, operational savings being sent on to consumers. So what is the average dollar amount, regardless of if anybody takes advantage of some of these apps or better managing it, just purely the savings that ComEd is getting from this that'll be passed on to the average household?
Yeah, so our business case, which we had to file with the ICC, so we have a formal business case on this. In that business case, it says we're going to spend over $2 billion on the installation of these meters. And it also says that just through the operational efficiencies, operational savings, reduced truck rolls, fewer meter readers, that there'll be over a $2 billion net return to the customers over the 20-year lifetime of the meters. Now, I'm not exactly sure how many dollars that breaks into, but the break-even point is about year 9, and we're in about year 4 right now. So as any capital investment, you invest up front, and then you reap the benefits, and you eventually you hit your break-even point, and then you go positive. So we're on track for that business case. We're doing a nice job of it. And it has billions of dollars in net benefits to the customers. Just based on operational savings, customer doesn't have to do anything.
But just to be clear, the $20 billion of the cost of this program, what's that?
It's about $2 billion, not 20.
Oh, $2 billion, okay.
Yeah, not 20.
So, but the customers are bearing that cost up front.
They are. Everybody is. That goes, we file annual rate cases. And the cost that we actually incurred in the program gets spread evenly across the entire rate base every year.
Thanks.
And then, if you've got any accountants, there's puts and takes, and the savings we achieve reduce the impact of that.
Anybody else have any other questions? I don't really have any other questions from the board, so.
Well, I just need to brief you on one last thing. This usually does come up as a question, but. Why do customers refuse meters? You could hear three primary reasons, well, maybe four. One is data privacy. People are afraid it is a wireless device. We are collecting the interval usage on 30-minute increments. They're afraid we'll sell that information to third parties. That one's the easiest to take care of. We will not. There's only a few ways we're going to release that data. One is if a customer asks us to. And there's a national program called Green Button Connect that enable the customer to say, please give my data to this particular supplier, for whatever reason that is. Or it's required by law, or it's anonymous. And we need that anonymous data in some third, meaning there's no account information, there's no names, there's no addresses. You need that to develop dynamic rates. Dynamic rates are prices of electricity on a real-time basis on an hourly time. Right now, everybody pays a flat rate, but the fact is rates fluctuate throughout the day, and in fact, overnight, they can go negative. So dynamic rates are an important constituent of that. The other is cybersecurity. They're afraid you can hack into the meter. Nobody today is going to tell you that anything's hack-proof. Nobody would. I certainly wouldn't have been brave enough to say that. But we have built cybersecurity into all our communications hardware, and it's able to be updated wirelessly. We hire people to hack into our system. If they identify vulnerabilities, we plug those. So we think we're about safe as you can get. Even if someone could hack into a smart meter, all they're going to get is the meter serial number and the kilowatt hour usage. There's no personal information on that data stream that all got synced up in the back office. And then the third reason is health effects. These are wireless devices. They're like your Wi-Fi router. They do operate on net 900 megahertz, which is the same frequency as probably the phone in your house, baby monitor, garage door opener. Nevertheless, they believe that it's radio frequency. Radio frequency can cause cancer. All I can tell you is I respect those opinions, but there's hundreds of peer review studies out there that say insufficient evidence to change any of the limits. Our meters are regulated. The communications in the meters regulated by the FCC. They've set limits on these. They're tested. We're well below the FCC limits that are associated with smart meters. And then the fourth reason is, well, none. I just don't want you here, which usually could be an indication of theft. And that's it. I just wanted you to be aware of that.
Well, thank you for that explanation. I think that's very helpful. If there's no further question by board members, I want to thank you for coming tonight and talking about smart meters, because this is something that's been in process for a number of years. So
it has. Yeah. Thank you very much. Right. We're glad to be here. Thanks for letting us in your community.
You know, okay, thank you so much. Moving on our agenda, we'll go into the next item, is liquor license application for Freedom Brothers Pizzeria at 6460 College Road. There's correspondence in our package. Just in case everybody's not familiar with 6460 College Road, is the former restaurant that was occupied by, former space that was occupied by Country House that moved out of there in the College Square Center. And they're opening up a pizzeria. I believe we have the petitioner here.
How you doing?
At the podium, maybe tell us a little bit about yourself.
Hello, Mr. Mayor, trustees. My name is David Sabota. This is my brother, Corey Sabota.
Hi there.
I'd like to tell you a little bit about our idea. We'd like to open up pizzeria in, like you said, the old Country House location at 6460 College. Freedom Brothers Pizza will be an entertaining, family-friendly dining experience with a rock and roll atmosphere. We will work closely with local farms for the freshest ingredients, and this farm-to-table process will help us serve the best wood-fired pizza in the area, along with sandwiches. We will also offer a large selection of American craft beers, artisanal wines, and inventive cocktails. We feel that 6460 College Road, Lyle, the former home of Country House for 30 years, is a perfect location. We love this location because of its rich restaurant history, the ample parking, its neighborhoods, and proximity to Benedictine University and Bennett High School. Because there's virtually there's very little competition in that area, we feel like we can create a great family-oriented restaurant and thrive for many years. The rock and roll concept isn't going to be something in your face like we speak of. It's more of a, the background music will be all rock and roll. There'll be rock and roll themed tables and memorabilia on the walls. Something for everyone to bring you back to your youth if you're a little older, or maybe some of the newer music out for the younger generation. Our menus will resemble old album covers, and the walls will be covered with, like I said, nostalgic memorabilia and photos. Our unique atmosphere and our fresh menu will make us incomparable to all the local competition. Give you a little background on myself and my brother's background. I used to own a bar in Chicago for many years, and we've been in the restaurant business going back to Prohibition. We had a restaurant in Chicago Heights and Dyer, Indiana, called Sabota's, and it was there for many years before we were even born, but it's in our blood, I guess you could say. And Corey can tell you a little bit about his background.
Yeah, I currently live in Chicago. I am a managing partner of an Irish pub called Division Ale House in Wicker Park. We've been successful for over 8 years now. I am starting a family. I'm going to be moving this way, hopefully Lyle or Naperville. I'm not sure where I'll be living yet. But
Lyle's closer to College.
I think Lyle's easier. I want to be able to walk to work if I can. So I brought business plans. Can I approach and give you guys a copy of the plan, please?
Thank you, sir.
That'll give a lot more detail to why we feel like that's a great location, and a lot more detail on our concept.
Well, it sounds like a good plan.
Thanks.
And I'm excited about this. So, board have any questions of the petitioner? If not, can I have a motion, please?
I move to authorize staff to increase the number of Class 2.2 liquor licenses by one.
Second.
There's a motion and second. Hearing no further discussion, all those in favor indicate by saying aye.
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 Those opposed? Hearing none, motion carries. Now, how this works now, as you go through the process, the board is authorized to increase liquor licenses by one for that class. As you get closer to opening date, Christine, our office manager, will be working with you, and then when it comes time, she'll give you all the instructions.
Great.
And then so many weeks beforehand, we'll increase the licenses so that license is yours. Okay?
Terrific. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much.
Great.
For coming
Thank
tonight.
Thank you. Thanks for having us. Look forward to feeding you.
Okay. Moving on our agenda tonight, the next item is 5100 5116 South Lincoln Avenue, ABC Discovery Daycare Special Use Permit. I believe we have the petitioner here.
Good evening. My name is Al Damascus. I'm the attorney for ABC Discovery Daycare Center. We're requesting a special use as well as for rezoning of part of the lot, which is now residential R2 to office, for a daycare center. And this is located at the southwest corner of Route 53 and Short Street. I have with me tonight the row right here, Auste Astroga, and Vida Urbana, who would be the directors of the school. And there is some remodeling and work to be done, and their husbands, Vito Astroga and Vidas Urba, are involved in real estate and construction. This is a 1.4 acre site with a 5,000 square foot office building that formerly was used by Morris Engineering up through October of last year. It's will need to be remodeled for purposes of a daycare center. We will be licensed by the state of Illinois, but the licensing cannot take place until we obtain the special use permit, and then we'll proceed to put that all in place. We appeared before the your Planning and Zoning Commission. We were unanimously approved, and there were three things that happened since that time. One is we were asked to prepare a final landscape plan. We presented that to your staff and went through and updated it several times with comments by them, and that's part of your packet. We also had discussions with Dan Garvey of the Lyle Park District because the Lyle Park District expressed interest in using our parking area for overflow parking at times when we don't use it, which would be evenings and Saturdays, primarily for soccer in the spring and the fall. We have since then reached an agreement, again subject to special use approval, that's been signed off by the Lyle Park District. We also have submitted a proposed sign because we had left open at that time signage, and we've submitted that to you this evening. We'd like to, right now there is an existing sign on the property, and we'd like to update it and improve it as staff had recommended. And on that, we've presented it to you with an aluminum sign and showing this with the colors, and we'd request approval for that. We'd appreciate your consideration. We'd love to be part of Lyle, and we think that there's room for this, and we'd like it to be approved. Thank you.
Okay, does any board members have any questions right now?
It's basically to staff.
Okay.
Is it my understanding that probably 50% plus of this lot is in the East Branch floodplain?
It is in the floodplain. It's not an issue related to this specific proposal based upon the improvements they're going to make. It's not going to exceed the 50% requirement.
Let me also comment on that. The building, our engineer is from Morris Engineering, who was in the building at the time of the large floods that took place. There was no flooding in the property itself. It is not in the existing floodplain, the building itself. There is a lot that is next to it on the west side where there's a home where there was some flood relief and is in the floodplain. But the building itself is not in the floodplain.
But the total lot, probably 50% of the lot is in the floodplain.
I don't know if it's 50%.
I'm guesstimating looking at it.
Yeah, the because what you've got is a, it goes up a little bit. Is the area to the west is closest to the you know, river right there, and closest to Riverview Drive. That would be, yes.
Okay.
I do notice that in the public hearing documents, there was some question about, some questions were came up about the parking lot.
Yes.
And I guess the response from you were that you were going to be taking care of the parking lot because it was always looked like it needed repair.
It does need repair, and we'd like to proceed initially as recommended by staff to do the seal coating and everything else. And as we start getting revenue in, we will do more improvements to it and improve it.
Anybody else have any other questions? If not, we have a motion to be presented.
I move to authorize staff to prepare the necessary ordinance for approval of a special use permit and rezoning of 5100-5116 Lincoln Avenue, consistent with the findings of facts and conditions outlined in the March 1st staff correspondence.
Second.
There's a motion and second. Hearing no further discussion, all those in favor indicate by saying aye.
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 Those opposed? No. Hearing none. Pardon? You opposed? One opposed. Hearing none, motion carries.
Good. Thank you for your consideration.
Now, this will be on the future agenda. Tony?
Yeah, I'm not sure if it'll go on the 21st or not, but we're going to try to do that.
Okay.
Thank you.
Moving on to the next item on our agenda, 4324 Yackley Avenue, DuPage AME, building code variations to the operate a food pantry. I believe we have the petitioners here.
Good evening, Mayor Barilla and Council. This is a continuation of the efforts on behalf of DuPage AME Church to request variances to allow the food pantry to operate from the existing house that is on the site that is owned now by the church. The food pantry is operating in a house on Warrenville Road right now, so we're basically just asking to allow the food pantry to move its operation to this existing house that the church owns, because it's being requested to vacate the property on Warrenville Road.
Okay. There was very detailed information in the board package that we received from them. Is there any questions by board members?
I move to authorize staff to prepare an ordinance approving building code variations for 4324 Yackley Avenue, consistent with the conditions outlined in the February 29th staff correspondence.
Thank you. Second.
There's a motion and second. Hearing no further discussion, all those in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
Those opposed? Hearing none, motion carries.
Thank you.
Thank you for being tonight. I'm going to adjust the agenda a little bit. I'm going to jump to item 6, and I'm going to skip item 5 for right now. So we're going into the Agave Restaurant grant, possible action. So.
Good evening.
Welcome again. Tonight we have information in our board package about the proposed restaurant, or the restaurant requesting a restaurant grant from us. And the correspondence was in the package. And if we have any questions of it, if not, it's pretty straightforward.
I move to approve a resolution authorizing execution of a restaurant grant program agreement for 1650 Maple Avenue.
Second.
There's a motion and second. Hearing no further discussion, all those in favor, indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Those opposed, motion carries. Now, this will be on a future agenda, or how's this going to happen?
You've just approved the resolution.
Okay, approved the resolution, okay. So, thank you. Can I ask you, when are you going to start the, start work on the project?
Next week.
Oh, next week, that's enough. Thank you.
Thank you.
Moving on our agenda, the next item number 7. Fair Housing Code Amendment. And I guess we had correspondence on this very detailing it, and staff will answer any questions that we may have.
Does David want to comment on it, or Tony, do you?
I can quickly just summarize. This is in response to the grant award, the CDBG grant award. from HUD, and one of the requirements that the federal government has is that our ordinances be in compliance with the Civil Rights Act of 1988. And just to take a step back, our ordinance was last amended in 1970, so it's been a while. And at the time, it was in compliance with the Civil Rights Act of 1968, which prohibited discrimination in the sale, rental, and financing of dwellings based upon race, color, religion, sex, or national origin. The amendments we're proposing here tonight would bring our ordinance into compliance with the Act of 1988, and the coverage is expanded to prohibit discrimination based upon a disability or a familial status. This act also established new administrative enforcement mechanisms and expanded the Justice Department's jurisdiction to bring suit on behalf of victims in federal district court. So we're looking to update the code to be in compliance with the Act of 1988, which is one of the prerequisites to getting the grant. What we're also doing is changing the portion of the code that this is located in. Right now it's in the police regulations for some reason. I'm assuming back in the 70s that was the appropriate location. We're going to relocate this to our building code. And then there's other actual amendments identified in the text of the ordinance that we've drafted. Those items that are stricken out are being removed from the current ordinance. Those items that are underlined and bolded are being added to the current ordinance to comply.
Does anybody have any questions from Tony or our attorney on this subject?
No, I think Tony did a great job.
Pardon?
I think Tony did a great job explaining it.
Okay, good job, Tony. Trustee Manuel.
Generic question. So that we're adhering now to the code of 1988.
Mm-hmm.
So that's 28 years ago. So what repercussions are there for not being in? I'm sure we're not the only ones that haven't been in compliance with 1988. So what are the repercussions? And if there's none, then why is there such regulations?
Well, okay, so the Fair Housing Act was comprehensively amended in 1988. That was the last time there were significant amendments to it. As Tony explained, your ordinance was written in response to the 1968 Civil Rights Act that introduced the fair housing provisions in the first place. Nothing had triggered your requirement to update your ordinance until you made the application for the CDBG grant. And as a requirement of that grant, you do have to bring your ordinances up to current federal standards on fair housing issues, and that's why this is before you tonight. You did already approve the CDBG-DR grant, so this follows that action to align your ordinance with federal law. That's the best explanation I can give. There just was no urgency previously to do anything about it. It's not as if people who were aggrieved in housing decisions in the village didn't have recourse through HUD's Office of Fair Housing Enforcement. But what HUD wants to see is that any recipient of grant money through the CDBG program, their ordinances are consistent with current fair housing laws.
That answer your question, Trustee Mandel? Mm-hmm.
Yeah, thank you.
Okay. Anybody else?
I was going to, just to be clear, be sure I heard you correctly, it's federal law now. So whether the village identified it or not, residents are still protected by that law. We're just pulling it into our and including it in our code.
They are, but HUD, again, the reason why you have to take action is because it's a specific requirement to getting the CDBG grant money that you approved the agreement with DuPage County earlier tonight.
Okay, so I'm going to throw another question out there just to be sure. Are there any other requirements from HUD that we have not already identified that are attached to the CDBG? I said that right.
No, right. You bring your ordinances into alignment with the Fair Housing Act. That's the key requirement.
And the other one, actually, and I referenced it in the first paragraph of the staff memo, the definition of family in the zoning code, and that's something we're going to go to the village to the plan commission in April to amend that definition. We're going to work with the village attorney on that.
But you are taking care of that you're setting the stage for that future zoning code amendment with these amendments, too.
Correct.
Thank you.
Okay. Any other questions? If not,
I move to authorize staff to prepare an ordinance revising the existing Fair Housing Code provisions as presented.
Second.
There's a motion and second. Hearing no further discussion, all those in favor indicate by saying aye.
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 Those opposed? Hearing none, motion carries. We'll go back to item number five, Ashton Place Subdivision Amendment Plan, amended plan. This was before us several weeks ago, and at that time there was questions from the board that were being addressed, and they're back before us tonight to address those questions.
Can I ask one question? There will be an annexation agreement associated with this, right?
Yes, okay. According to the petition that's been submitted.
Okay, because I did want to clarify one thing in the staff report. Read in isolation, it suggested that to adopt the annexation ordinance under 718 of the annexation statutes, that a voluntary annexation would require 5 votes. That's not true. It's a simple majority. However, you're going to hold a public hearing on the annexation agreement, and to approve the annexation agreement, that does require a 3/5 vote.
State your name and address for the record, please.
John Lozinski with Oak Creek Capital Partners, 3N680, James Fenimore Cooper Lane, St. Charles, Illinois. I gotta put the pictures up on the... On the board is, or on the picture up there, is our site plan that we reviewed with the village board here on December 7th. It is the site plan we had worked with and had come to an operating agreement outline with the Lyle Park District. Since that time, when we were here on December 7th, five of the board members favored the site plan, three did not, and obviously that's not a, or four and three. That was not enough to secure annexation approval. While it did get a site plan approval, it did not get site enough for annexation. What we did in this plan, just to remember, refresh you, was an 8.5 acre site with a park site that we would be developing as a joint operation with the Lyle Park District, and had 27 units mostly in duplex form, but we did have 1 3-unit building. So we had 12 duplex buildings and 1 triplex. After that meeting, we went and talked with a couple of the aldermen or village board members who were not in favor of the plan at that moment in time. And we came back with an alternative. Let's go to the one without the... Yeah, hold on. There it is. This is the revised site plan, working again with the same 8.5 acres, and relocates the park from being on the north property line down to being basically in the middle of the site plan. Some of the concerns raised by at least one of the trustees seem to address it. It does provide a nice centerpiece for the community. While we have reviewed this with the Park District, we do understand the Park District has concerns with this, because the biggest concern being that this is in the middle of the Ashton Place proposal now, and it feels more like a Ashton Place amenity versus a park for the Lyle Park District residents as a whole. That would be something we'd have to work out with the Park District moving forward. But where the last plan, we had something where we came to you with the Park District in tow, and they were supporting, and the Village Board was not in concert with, we figured come to you, see if we could get consensus on something, and then try to work out the details with the Park District. In the letter of February 24th, we raised what those concerns are with the park that the Park District has. Obviously, there is a slight reduction in the actual park acreage. To minimize that, we went to a 50-foot right-of-way, which is the same as Lillian Lane, for our roadway around the site. Now, that would be an offset 50. We would have 30 feet on the residential side and 20 feet on the park side. That would allow us to maximize the park acreage. Site plan does provide, obviously, a lot of guest parking for both the park site as well as the residents that would live in Ashton Place. One of the concerns with the Park District was, as residents look out at the park and people from outside Ashton Place came to the park site, they, you know, may or may not feel welcome. So those are details we would have to work out with the Park District before we could come back to you for a annexation hearing. The plan, other than that, is substantially similar to the initial plan, other than putting the park in the middle. We did relocate the stormwater management further to the south. That provides somebody at the intersection of Yakely and Warrenville Avenue, kind of a crescent-shaped view of open space from that intersection all the way to Leask Lane. This does have one more additional unit, as well as roughly another 340 feet of public roadway. Other than that, everything was pretty much outlined in the staff report and our letter of February 24th. With that, I offer to address any questions or comments.
I'll yield to the board. Any questions by board members? Comments, any way, shape, or form?
What we did, obviously that's the site plan, so it doesn't address the facade directly. What I do have is a separate handout. What we would do, and for this site plan, it would be the two corner buildings on Leask Lane, the one, I can't read the numbers up there, going up to the street to the north, and the one next to the pond. We would address with rear elevations, as we went out there and looked at what Trustee Getz proposed, actually all of those would have been hidden by landscaping. And if you look at Exeter, you don't see those at this point now. So what we're proposing to do is do the enhanced elevation for those four buildings that have side impacts towards the road to the public roadways. And in these, you can see they added some gables on the back, brought the brick around on the side elevations as requested by Trustee Getz.
Trustee Mandel?
One of the concerns I had was, it seemed like in the first proposal, the Park District and yourself were pretty much in concert on
we
the park,
100%
the design and everything. And yes. Then now it seems like there's quite a bit of disagreement or there's not agreement. And my question is why, how far apart are you and I guess, why propose this now if there's not agreement on the park? Because it seems like that's an integral part of this whole overall plan.
You're right. The original plan was 100% in concert, us and the park district. As you know, Dan Garvey, who couldn't be here today for other commitments, spoke in behalf of that plan. We have presented this plan to him after we worked with staff to get to this point. He will need to take this to the board, and we will have to work something out with the board at that point. Currently, his straw poll does not think there's unanimous support at the board. We will need to work that out. Where before we came to you with something, with a agreed upon plan, and you know, basically it was vetoed because we couldn't get the annexation approval. They would prefer unequivocally we stay with the initial plan. All right, I'm not trying to say anything different than that. If it's the village's board's desire for us to proceed with this plan, we need to see if we can go work that out. We may not be able to work it out, but given the level of cooperation we and the park district have worked together with over the last 18 months, I'm fairly confident we can come to some type of arrangement. You know, we've worked a lot of details out in the past with them. We may not. And if we can't work it out with them, quite frankly, our proposal will die at that point. But we felt it was not fair to go back, try to work out another agreement in detail with the park district, and come back to you for something that may or may not be acceptable to you. We figured, let's find out exactly, can we proceed, and then see if we can work out with them before we come back to a public hearing. But please understand, they would prefer the original plan.
And the original plan did not fly with the board here. So.
The original plan had enough for site plan approval, but didn't have enough vote
Correct.
For annexation approval.
Correct. Is there any other questions by board members?
Well, that was my concern, is we had agreement with the park district before, and now we don't.
So well, we got to see if we can get it, but we wanted to make sure this, no sense of working another agreement out with the park district if this is not acceptable to the board. Or would the board consider the original plan? Now, one of the questions.
That's actually putting the cart before the horse, because really what has to happen here is you had plan commission approval for your original plan.
Yes, we had unanimous.
Then because of the discussion that apparently happened here on that recommendation, you had to go back to redesign the layout of the site. So really the only thing that can happen here today is we're okay with it. Why don't you proceed back to the plan commission so that they can look at your revised plan and then give us another recommendation, which may or may not be approval
correct,
of
correct.
This one.
Correct.
And in the meantime, your discussions with the Lyle Park District go on. So really what this board needs to do is decide whether this is even remotely acceptable to it to allow them to go back to the plan commission to get a new recommendation on this site plan.
Exactly. Yeah, this is the straw poll stage.
Right. And, you know, that's where we're here tonight.
Now, the other thing I just put up there, there was a question towards the end of the meeting on December 7th. What could the possibility of the properties to the north of us be? So we had the planner with this, with both site plans, show what the northerly two pieces that we do not control. We did try to engage those property owners post December 7th, and at current market conditions, they're not ready to sell. What that can be, and it does show 18 single family lots with the stormwater management facility. But this will give you an idea of how potentially the property to the north could develop. You know, and again, staff wanted us to look at, and as we've done through the whole process, what is the logical extension of this development in the future?
Okay, so the question before, anybody else have any questions?
Let me just say where I'm at with all of this. I was one of the three votes that voted against this on December 7th, I think it was. I had three questions. I went and talked to these gentlemen again a month ago. I'm not even sure when it was. My questions had to deal with the price points of the property, the density of the property, and then I wasn't sure who was driving the equation on where the park should, I know where the park district was, they wanted their park in a certain place, but it wasn't being addressed with the village input into it and the neighborhoods being put into it at the same time. I did believe that this project is a glass half full, not half empty. That's why I sat down and did have a discussion. Coming back, they came back with this plan. I think it addresses one of my three concerns, but I think it's my most important one, and that is, even though we're still talking, is it 28 units here? The density, the perceived density, the way it flows on those two lots is completely different than what it was before. So with that being said, I was definitely more enthusiastic than what I saw, you know, a couple months ago.
Any other comments? Well, with that, we have a suggested motion, so does anybody want to make that motion?
Do we need to do a motion, or do they need to, I guess this is for the attorney. I didn't get it when I saw it.
Well, you are going to be sending it back to the Planning and Zoning Commission because this is, for all practical purposes, a new plan.
Different plan.
So they're here tonight to just kind of get an initial reaction from you. The only thing you need to do is send it back to Planning and Zoning Commission. They'll hold a new public hearing, they'll make a new recommendation, and then it'll be back before you, not only for annexation agreement public hearing, which will lay out the terms of development for the site, but also zoning, and then eventually an annexation ordinance with that.
But I think the most important thing, if we don't like this plan, let's not waste everybody's time.
Yeah, they don't want to go back to the park district unless they can find some layout that would generally meet with your, at least your initial impressions of approval. You're not committing yourself one way or the other.
I move to direct the petitioner for the proposed Ashton Place subdivision to file for review of a revised project proposal by the P&Z Commission, contingent upon further petitioner discussion with the Park District.
Second.
There's a motion and second. Is there any further discussion by board members? Hearing none, all those in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Nay. Who's opposed? In opposition?
No.
No.
Who said? I heard two.
And trustee Wetzel.
So three. So that's.
Do you want to poll the board just to make sure?
I think let's do that. Let's have. I'm going to have to take a roll. Just we have it on record.
Trustee Boyle.
Yes.
Trustee Carballo.
Yes.
Trustee Kowitzel.
No.
Trustee Hedick.
No.
Trustee Mandel.
No.
Mayor votes aye, and it doesn't matter. It fails.
Thank you.
Moving on our agenda tonight is open forum. Is there anyone in the audience that wishes to speak at open forum that did not sign up? Let the record show that there's none. Move on to village staff.
We have a proposed CMAP downtown parking study before you tonight. You've seen this document substantially in the form it's in at a previous workshop, and we are recommending, consistent with our workshop discussion, that we move forward to sign the agreement with CMAP.
Is there any questions, comments? If not, a motion, please.
I move to approve a resolution authorizing the execution of an agreement with the Chicago Metropolitan Agency for Planning, CMAP, for a downtown parking study.
Second.
This is a motion. I motion and second. There being no further discussion, will the village clerk please take the roll?
Trustee Boyle?
Aye.
Trustee Hedick?
Aye.
Trustee Carballo?
Aye.
Trustee Kowitzel?
No.
Trustee Mandel?
Aye.
Motion carries.
We have one item, that's the a pamphlet, a flyer regarding Sustainable Saturday. Clerk Seaton has already announced that at the front end of this meeting, and we would simply repeat that we hope people will keep an eye on the website and attend that event on March 19th. Thank you.
Okay, moving on our agenda. Trustee Boyle.
Just piggybacking on what Jerry just said, I got the email the other day on Sustainable Saturday. I sent it out to 10 people. I know it went out to another 50 after that. If you can piggyback that, pass that email along so more people know about it. Thank you.
Trustee Kowitzel?
No, thank you.
Trustee Carballo?
Nothing, thank you.
Trustee Hedick?
Nothing, thank you.
Trustee Mandel?
Nothing, thank you.
Well, I have one final item. I just want to issue or put out a congratulations to Bennett for the girls' basketball for winning their two-peat, second champion, state championship in a row after winning it last year. They come back and they won it again this year. So we've got a very good basketball team at Bennett University, Bennett Academy. I upgraded them. So with that, we'll go into
Mayor, the just for the record, I have no report tonight.
Pardon?
I have no report tonight.
Well, I figured that. See, I turned the page too fast. I have a motion to go into executive session, please.
I move to adjourn the regular meeting and go into closed session to discuss setting the price for sale or lease of village-owned property.
Second.
There's a motion and second. Will the village clerk please take the roll?
Trustee Boyle?
Aye.
Trustee Mandel?
Aye.
Trustee Carballo?
Aye.
Trustee Kowitzel?
Aye.
Trustee Hedick?
Aye.
Mayor Brodo?
Aye, and motion carries. We're adjourned to executive session.